These are the times that late night hosts open themselves up for the world to see. Welcome to WatchMojo.com, and today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 times late night hosts got personal. Before we begin, we publish new videos every day, so be sure to subscribe for more great content. For this list, we're taking a look at the moments when a late night host showed a more personal side during their television shows. These instances can involve personal stories or strong emotions towards an issue from any point in television history. Get ready for the feels. Number 10, Craig Ferguson discusses his sobriety, The Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson. Craig never failed to bring the laughs, but he didn't shy away from tackling serious issues either. During a monologue, he began talking about a then-troubled Britney Spears.
No Britney Spears jokes, and here's why.
The audience is expecting some low-grade hanging fruit, but Ferguson takes a turn.
It reminds me of where I was 15 years ago when I was living like that.
After talking about Britney Spears entering rehab and her apparent alcohol addiction, he tells his own story of alcohol addiction and his subsequent 15 years of sobriety up to that point. Ferguson manages to be frank, but he throws in some self-deprecating humor too, while also giving the audience a glimpse into the mental process and actions of someone with a serious addiction.
The only way I could deal with it is find other people who had similar experiences and talk to them. It doesn't cost anything.
Number 9, John Oliver and vaccinating his son. Last Week Tonight with John Oliver. John Oliver is known for his humorous yet informative deep dives into important topics. And Oliver isn't shy about using his own experiences to help make his point. A great example is his piece about vaccinations. At the end of the almost 30-minute segment about the issue of getting vaccinated, and more importantly, vaccinating your children, Oliver showed a picture of him and his 19-month-old son.
He is 19 months old. He was born prematurely following a very difficult pregnancy, and I've worried about his health, and I still worry about his health a lot.
After giving details about his son's premature birth, Oliver stated that he was going to go ahead with his scheduled vaccinations, despite being a worried parent like everyone else. He then encouraged others to do the same.
I can overcome the temptation to listen to the irrational shouting of my terrified lizard brain, then I believe that everyone can.
Number 8, Jimmy Fallon cries following his mother's passing. The Tonight Show starring Jimmy Fallon. Jimmy Fallon's show is known for being fun, upbeat, and lighthearted. Whether it be a rap battle with Justin Timberlake or celebrities trying the latest trend, Fallon manages to give audiences something different and entertaining. That's what makes it all the more noticeable when Fallon takes a more serious tone, like he did when his mother passed away.
She was the best audience. She was the one I was always trying to make laugh, and she was such a fan of the show and everything I did.
Fallon is usually bright and animated, but as he details a special memory of his mother, he is on the brink of tears.
Mom, I'll never stop trying to make you laugh. I love you.
Despite being choked up and crying during multiple moments, Fallon manages to still tell the audience that he hopes to bring them laughter. Number 7, Trevor Noah on Philando Castile, The Daily Show. Trevor Noah is no stranger to serious topics, but he's also the host of The Daily Show, so he's gonna make us laugh about them.
I was stopped in a Tesla. Like a Tesla, people. Like, I don't know what silent crime you think I'm on my way to commit.
He even does just that between his planned monologues as well. During one of his off-the-cuff conversations with the studio audience, Noah candidly discusses the death of Philando Castile, who was killed by police during a traffic stop, and the acquittal of the officer who killed him.
When you flip it in these situations, you realize, you're like, there's no way, there's almost no way to not get shot.
Trevor uses his own personal experiences with the US police to emphasize his points about racism, profiling, and police reform, which managed to be funny, yet extremely alarming.
He was running away. His back was turned to the officer, he's running away. Where's the threat? No one's threatening from behind. Do you know what I mean? Maybe a Kardashian, but no one else.
Number 6, David Letterman apologizing to his wife on air. Late Show with David Letterman. In the midst of a quashed blackmail campaign, David Letterman used his show to address the matter directly.
No, I'm not having sex with these women. Those episodes are in the past.
Addressing his past and allegations of sexual relationships with multiple staff members, Letterman not only took time to apologize to his crew for putting them through such a stressful time, but to his wife as well. In an extremely personal moment, Letterman told the audience he had hurt his wife immensely due to his actions, and that he had a lot of work to do to make things right.
Let me tell you, folks, I got my work cut out for me.
Letterman isn't a stranger to sincere personal moments, and his tribute to the late Robin Williams alone is proof of that.
I'm sorry, like everybody else, I had no idea that the man was in pain, that the man was suffering. But what a guy, Robin Williams.
Number 5, Johnny Carson's final monologue, The Tonight Show starring Johnny Carson. One of the most revered late-night hosts doesn't just go out with a whimper. During his final monologue after nearly 30 years of his late-night show, Johnny Carson was met with a standing ovation that lasted for around 2 minutes, with the ever-modest Carson almost begging the audience to stop.
Thank you very much. Please. I want you to know I really appreciate it.
Glassy-eyed and noticeably flustered after the long applause, he still managed to carry himself and make the audience laugh one last time during his monologue.
I'm gonna have to be very honest with you. I don't know if I can take another night of this.
The only time the audience ever stopped laughing was when Carson talked about his departure. Then he was met with a very loud aw from the crowd.
All we have is tonight and tomorrow, and I'm gone? God, I haven't used that line since World War II.
Number 4, James Corden and the Westminster Attack. The Late Late Show with James Corden. After the first of multiple terror attacks in London in 2017, James Corden addressed the audience about the incident that took place in his hometown. During his response, he expressed his sorrow, but more importantly, his homesickness.
When something like that happens in your hometown, you don't have a feeling of being glad that you're so far away. What you feel is that you wish you could be there.
While choking up, Corden mentioned how it would be natural to assume that he felt better being so far away across the Atlantic. Instead, he wished he could have been there to help Londoners recover.
If this act of terrorism was supposed to divide the people of London, I know for a fact that all something like this does is bring them closer together.
Only a few months later, Corden had to address a second terror attack in London. However, he got to do it his way from London, helping it recover by celebrating it.
I'm proud to show off its beauty, its diversity, and its stoic British determination to let nothing or anybody stand in our way.
Number 3, Conan O'Brien on the Las Vegas shooting. Conan. Sadly, Conan O'Brien isn't a stranger to addressing mass shootings in the US. Far from it, actually, since multiple and some of the deadliest have occurred in 2017 alone.
When did that become normal? When did this become a ritual?
Despite this, little to no legislative action has happened, which is key to understanding Conan's behavior. Using his monologue to address the Las Vegas massacre, Conan expressed not only his sympathy, but also his anguish.
I don't think it should be so easy for one demented person to kill so many people so quickly.
He even remarks how mass shootings occur so frequently, a file exists of his previous responses to them. What's so significant about this moment is Conan's palpable sense of defeat and exhaustion.
Something needs to change. It really does.
Number 2, Jon Stewart's monologue after 9/11, The Daily Show. After the 9/11 attack in New York City, Jon Stewart, known for his declaration of the war on bullshit, opened his next show with a very emotional monologue about the disaster.
I wanted to tell you why I grieve. But why I don't despair.
Choking up and visibly crying, Stewart mainly focused on the heroic first responders that put their lives on the line to help those affected immediately after the attack.
That's extraordinary. And that's why we've already won.
It really gets us when John, who was born and raised in New York City, also mentions how the view from his home has drastically changed, with the World Trade Center no longer visible from his window.
The view from the south of Manhattan is now the Statue of Liberty.
Before we unveil our number one pick, here are some honorable mentions.
It's important for everyone, especially white people in this country, to speak out against this. Ignoring it is just as bad as supporting it.
It's been a great institution for 60 years. I'm so glad I got to be a part of it, but it really is time to go hand it off to the next guy. It really is.
Nobody in life gets exactly what they thought they were going to get. But if you work really hard and you're kind, amazing things will happen.
Number 1, Jimmy Kimmel and his son's medical problem. Jimmy Kimmel Live. The death of Cecil the Lion famously left Kimmel a bit choked up and bewildered.
An a-hole dentist who wants a lion's head over the fireplace in his man cave so his douchebag buddies can gather around it and drink scotch and tell him how awesome he is. That's just vomitous.
But family is different. While the debate to repeal Obamacare was steaming ahead, Jimmy Kimmel told a tear-jerking story about his son's health complications when he was born a few days previously.
And it's a terrifying thing. You know, my wife is back in the recovery room. She has no idea what's going on.
Kimmel emphasized that had he not had health coverage, his son would not have been able to receive the care he needed to save his life due to his having a pre-existing condition.
No parent should ever have to decide if they can afford to save their child's life.
He later brought his son on the show to help fund the Children's Health Insurance Program. And we all teared up all over again.
Daddy cries on TV, but Billy doesn't. It's unbelievable.
Do you agree with our picks? Check out these other great clips from WatchMojo and subscribe for new videos every day.